Hello, and thank you so much for joining us today. This is Sharing Hope, brought to you by Medi-Share. My name is Sharita Bent. I am the marketing manager at Medi-Share, and it is my pleasure today to bring such a special treat to you all. We are getting to talk with Annie F. Downs. She's an amazing woman, an author. She's a nationally known speaker. She's a podcast host. I follow her on all social media platforms, and I would encourage you to do the same as well. We're going to talk about her amazing book that she just wrote and a few fun things about Enneagram. So here we go. Annie, you ready? You excited?
I'm so ready, Sharita. Let's go, girl.
I know.
That was a very kind intro. Thank you. You're like, she's kind of everywhere, and it's annoying.
Amazing. I love her. And we both are the same type in the Enneagram.
So yes, we both identify as same type. That's right.
Yes, yes. So tell me before we even jump in, like, how are you doing with quarantine? How is that going at your home and your life,
yeah,
and family? How's that going?
So I'm not married yet and I don't have kids yet. And so it is just me.
Just
you. And I don't have a pet. And so it is literally just me. And I'm incredibly extroverted. I even said to a friend yesterday, I went to the park last week. I found a park in walking distance. Didn't know it existed the last 2 years I've lived here. And when I got there, I was like, why do I feel so like alive? And what is this? And so I asked myself, cause I think it's very kind to be kind to yourself. So I was like, okay, what is this? Why do I feel this way? And I was like, all these people are strangers. I haven't been around strangers. Like, I love the hubbub of being around strangers, and we just haven't gotten to do that for almost 40 days at the time we're recording this for me. And so it's been really hard. It's been good. There's been kindness in it from God that I didn't expect. And there's been pain and suffering I didn't expect. I think everybody has felt that in a lot of ways.
Absolutely, girl. I can totally relate to what you're saying. And if you want to get on and have like a party or something, if you're missing people, you can holler at me and my family any of our peeps.
How many people live in your house with you?
Yeah. So it's me, my husband, and my son. My son is 13, and we have a little feisty cat as well. Her name is Cookie. And so,
see, that's great. That sounds like a really good family unit that like, that's a lot of time together. So there's moments, I'm sure, but you're like, hey, the three of us know how to operate. He's independent. He's independent. I'm independent. That's great.
It's true. We come together, have our little times, and we're like, yeah, hey, let's do our own thing now for a little while.
Yeah.
So, yeah. That's cool. But I can relate to what you said about the beauty in it, the blessings, the suffering. It's kind of like we're all in this mode of learning.
That's right. And if, I mean, the reality is something that I have had to learn in a lot of different ways in the last probably 5 years is how to hold joy and suffering at the same time. Mm. I always thought I had to pick one or the other. And if I was having a great time, then I couldn't feel sadness. Mm. And if I was sad, just dive all the way in. Don't find any gift in it at all. Yeah. And what we learned from Inside Out, that Disney movie, and what we know is true in our bones, and actually what scripture says, where it says that even in laughter, the heart may ache. It says in Proverbs, you go like, oh, these were always meant to be together. They're better together. And so on the days where I feel like my heart's broken about something, or I feel like I'm disappointed, I ask God for the gift. Mm. And I go, okay, I've got to be able to hold both of these. And the day where there's a lot of joy and then there's sudden sadness. I mean, people are like, did you have a good day? I was like, I need you to break that down into hours. like the morning was fine and lunch was hard and the afternoon was good. And at night I was sad. You know, it's like all of that happens in a day. And I think the kindest thing we can do for each other right now, specifically in everybody's home, but I think this will remain true. I hope this is something I adopt in my life is, when someone tells you what they are experiencing is hard, we should just believe them.
Amen.
That's the kindest thing we can do is go, yeah, your life is different than mine, but I bet that is hard.
Amen.
And if you say it's hard to you, I believe you.
Yes. Oh, Annie, that's good, girl. I'm like, preach. I need a white handkerchief or something over here to wave.
Yeah. You can do it.
That's good, because especially the joy and, you know, the grief, holding hands and being in the same room, that's rich.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. That's rich.
It is the better way to live, I think. Yeah. That's what I've experienced is I think I thought if I cut one out, the other would feel better. Like I thought if I cut out joy, I thought if I cut out sadness, the joy would be skyrocketed. And what's actually true is they are both more vibrant together. And so the joys are higher and some of the sadnesses are probably sadder, but I'm not muted at that top and bottom level anymore. And I think I was for a while.
I love that. I can
relate.
Ooh, yeah. That's good. Girl, preach. It's really good. And it's healthy, right? Because we're going through this journey, going through the dips and the high parts and honoring all of it.
And that's we've never done this before, right? Like, it's not even like we can ask our grandparents how to be quarantined to your house by yourself, right? So there's just got to be my hope when this is over soon. I hope it ends soon. And my hope is when it's over that we don't necessarily go back to what we had before, but we really kind of go like, what did I learn? I learned that being graceful with people because they've never done today is actually still true at Christmas of 2020. People still have never done this day before. And so I hope we take grace with us. I hope we take kindness with us to believe people's stories. And I hope there is a lot gained in this time. I feel like when the Lord gives you a lot of extra time to build your spiritual muscles, it means you're going to get to use them. Amen. And I hope that's what comes on the other side of this very, very soon. Yes. Let me out of my house.
Yes. Let us out.
Let me go back to work. Yeah. Even though my studio is very fancy with this blanket nailed to the wall.
I like it. It's the quarantine edition.
You get it.
Like,
you get
we're working
it.
With what we got.
That's right.
Well, I wanted to ask you a little bit about the Enneagram. I know we're mostly going to talk about your book, but I know you love the Enneagram. You're a student of the Enneagram. You've read and studied it a lot. And I know we've bonded over the fact that we're both sevens and like to have fun. But I wanted to ask you, sometimes when I read through the different types, even though I know I'm a seven, I still resonate with all the different types in some way where I'm like, oh yeah, I'm a little bit of that. And so is that normal or am I off with that? Like, what is your...
Yeah, you know, like you said, I'm not an expert at it. I'm not a coach at it, but I just really love learning about the Enneagram. I feel like for me personally, this particular motivation assessment, as much as anything, has helped my spiritual growth so much. I would say there's a couple of things that I think when it comes to that question. Number one, Jesus, when he was on the planet, he was all of them, right? He was fully human and fully God. And so he reflected every personality type. And so I think there are moments because we are made in the image of God where we can reflect whatever the people we are with need or whatever we need. And so there are times where it is not natural for me to be helpful. That's not what a person who identifies as a seven like runs to. I'm not the one who shows up when something's going sideways, but a friend of mine's dad died yesterday. And so I've showed up, you know, like there's a way you can, and so you do see your behaviors matching other type behaviors, because when we are in line with the fruit of the Spirit and when we're in line with who God is and who he, and if we can reflect him to the world, we're going to look not just like our personality. We're going to look mostly like our personality, but I think there are times that we look like others and all of them. And so I think what that actually says to me, Sharita, is you're incredibly healthy and that you are able to see gifts that you offer the world that don't just align with the way your personality naturally does. I mean, it's the trick of, you're 100% more married than I am, but it's the trick of love languages is you don't just get to love people in the way you want to be loved. You have to figure out who they are and love them the way they are. It doesn't mean you are that love language or that that is your top one. It just means that you're sacrificing to be who they need you to be. And I think that happens with behaviors around the Enneagram as well.
Wow, that is beautiful. And just the way you described like Jesus Christ, man, the beauty of that and how we're, you know,
best.
And we know scripture says we're fearfully and wonderfully made. And it's just so much beauty in that, you know?
Yeah, that's right.
This is super random, but I think we might have on the same lipstick.
It does look so similar. What are you working with?
Sure. Mine is, I think it's called Ruby Woo by MAC.
Yes, girl.
Is that yours?
Yes. You have to. It is the red. It's the red. I mean, you can walk into MAC and be like, ugh, someone told me. And they go, Ruby Woo.
Yes.
You're like, that is what they said.
That's what I did.
Yes. I did the same. I was on a tour and two of the other speakers on the tour, well, one musician and one speaker were both like wearing it. And I was like, I need that red. Yeah. They're like, everybody needs that red. And just for everyone watching, in case you didn't notice, our skin tones are different.
Sharita and I are wearing the
same lip color and it looks right on both of us. That's the trick.
Yes. We are fabulous. When you were talking, I was just like, I love her lipstick. And then I was like, wait,
hold on. I think I'm wearing that. Yes, you are. Ruby Woo, girl.
Ruby Woo for the win.
That's right.
Okay, so now I want to talk about your new book. And I just love the title, the timeliness even of it as to what we're dealing with right now. I guess I'm just curious, what was the journey even like for you coming to write this? I mean, obviously you didn't know COVID was going to happen and sure. It was going to, you know, be at this time. What was that journey like?
You mean 100 Days to Brave, right?
Yes. What did I say?
You didn't say. I was just making sure I was on the same. Yes. Yeah, because we the book itself has existed for a couple of years, but what just released is a leather-bound cover and a Spanish edition. Ooh. So now it's available in English, German, Spanish, leather. I know. I mean, what a miracle that I can write a book in one language and it can be translated so that people on another part of the globe or that are my next-door neighbors can read it. And it feels like such an honor. I work with a sponsor kid with a nonprofit with Compassion International, and to get to take a book in Spanish to his family when I went to Honduras a couple of months ago was just unbelievable. Yeah. But so here's the thing about 100 Days to Brave. A few years ago, I wrote a book called Let's All Be Brave. And it was really my story of moving from Atlanta to Nashville, which is not very far apart for all you geography buffs. But it was a massive move for me. I didn't go that far from home when I went to college. I never planned to move away from my hometown. I don't live in a hometown that people leave. I live in a hometown where everybody stays, is where I grew up. And I was the only one who left. And it's great when I go home for Christmas because I can see everybody.
Yeah.
But I'm the only one who comes home. Everyone else is still home there. And so there's grieving to that, but there's also obedience that has opened up a life to me that I didn't know the Lord had for me. So I wrote Let's All Be Brave. It was that journey. It was some of my Nashville life. There was a time a couple of years ago when I moved to Scotland for a while. So that's in that book. And what happened is after that book came out, Sherita, people would say to me, I loved Let's All Be Brave. What do I do now? And I was like, oh, yeah. Wow. Like, I gave a lot of handholds in that book, but I didn't give direct direction. I didn't give like, try this, because it's so, you can't do that in a memoir, you know?
Sure.
And so then I was like, well, if you do anything for 100 days, you're going to be different. If you eat different for 100 days, if you do sit-ups for 100 days, if you eat marshmallows for 100 days, if you go on a walk for 100 days, I mean, everybody knows if you brush your teeth, if you floss for 100 days, it changes you.
True.
If you read, if you set aside time to read for 100 days, it doesn't take very long to build a new habit. But 365 days for me and my personality felt very daunting.
Yeah.
To think, you mean for a whole year I got to work on this? I will miss a day and then suddenly I'll be off and there will be no recovering. And I cannot tell you, Sherita, it has made me laugh so hard how many people say, I just finished 100 Days to Brave in a year. I'm like, my girl.
Yes.
My dude, you are. We are on the same page, right?
Great.
So that was it. Yeah. And I just thought, okay, this gives me a chance to talk about some real specific areas. Let's talk about your job and your calling. Let's talk about relationships. Let's talk about your health. Let's talk about where you want to go. Let's talk about your family life. I mean, so we got to split it up into these different areas and go like, okay, we're going to spend like 8 days here. And what ends up happening, I say to people every time we've, at most Januaries, we start a 100 Days to Brave group and thousands of people will do the book together. And I say, when all those people sign up in January, I'm like, great. You've got to finish. Like, I don't care if it takes you a little bit longer. We're all going to finish in April, but if you need a little bit more time, that's great, because the secret sauce to 100 Days to Brave is finishing. Because when you've gotten to the end, you've covered all these different areas, and always, always one of them is something God had for you, if not more.
Wow.
It's not because of me. I'm not magical. It's because the Lord, if you will put your hand and heart to knowing him better, and if you will put your hand in your heart and your mind into going like, what would it look like if I was braver on behalf of what God has for me? He won't let you miss him. Wow. He's not going to miss that opportunity with you. And so that's what we see over and over. I mean, people come up and go, you couldn't have known that on day 35, I would lose my job. Or you couldn't have known that on day 80, I would go on a first date and now that girl is my wife.
Wow.
Or you couldn't have known that one of my parents would pass away or we would get pregnant. Or, I mean, I had a girl who sent me, a married couple actually sent me when they started on day one that they were trying to get pregnant. And a year later, they sent me a picture of a baby.
Oh my goodness.
And they were like, the Lord, they've been trying. And so That has nothing to do with me. I just typed it up one time, you know.
How beautiful.
And it is awesome. It's just awesome to see when people will be willing to go on that journey all the way to the end, what God will do for them and in them.
Mm, that is rich. And so when you're talking about these groups that are, you know, going through this journey, is it like your coworkers? Is it families? Is it a mixture? Just you,
yeah,
go through it,
you know,
with
it's
friends?
So fun. A lot of times it's teachers. There's a lot of groups of teachers in public schools and in private schools that will go through it together.
Wow.
And I think that is so, I used to teach elementary school. It's what I studied in college. And yep. So this idea that there are groups of teachers sitting around reading a book I write just makes me fall to pieces.
I
just
that.
Cry about it. It's so sweet. Oh. So groups of teachers will do it. We have a bunch of groups of nurses who've done it. Small groups at churches do it now with the leather cover. The original cover is beautiful.
Yeah.
It's pink and gold. And so now with the leather cover, I have less complaints from men about like, hey, I love the book. You're making me walk around with a sparkly gold cover, Downs, you know? So now with the leather cover, there's a lot more like entire baseball teams being gifted it at the end of the year, entire wedding parties being gifted the book on both sides, and then they go through it together. So the groups are as varied as your friend groups are.
Nice. I love that. I really do.
It's so fun. It's so crazy. I'm so thankful.
So what do you think for you? Because I know you're saying it started with a move and all these other components. What was like your big takeaway from this journey, like for yourself? I'm sure there's so many. But what would be one major takeaway?
I mean, I say this a lot. I love confetti poppers. I might have one in reach.
Yes.
I don't have one in reach. Oh, no, I don't, but it is just on the other side of the room. They are never far from me. I can get to a confetti popper pretty quickly. Faster than I can get to a bottle of water, which is a problem. But what I think is true about courage is if you are brave, it is like setting off a confetti popper in your life and confetti gets on everybody else. And you just can't, you can't be brave in your life without the shrapnel affecting the people around you in the best ways. And so what I have, my journey has been, some of these stories were really hard for me to tell. And it still feels true. There are stories that feel very hard for me to tell. And yet if I will just do my one thing in my one life, the confetti will get on people. And so it doesn't matter if you have a 12 people in your small group or 3 people in your home or 100,000 people following you on Instagram. If you will do your part to be brave, it will change the world you live in.
Yeah.
And so I have just experienced that. I mean, people reading the book in Germany and in Spain and in Mexico and all, you know, like, I don't deserve any of that. I just told a story that was hard for me to tell. And the Lord took that confetti and popped it in a lot of different places.
Yeah. Wow. So you're like a living illustration of this, where it's like,
yes, girl,
being
100%.
Willing. Love it. I love it.
That seems to be true. I've written a handful of books, and what keeps being true is God never gives me the opportunity to write books about stuff I'm good at. I wish he would. I wish I could. I can fold a fitted sheet.
Yeah.
I can make chicken and dumplings.
That is a skill, girl. That
is a skill. Thank you. I know. I feel the same way.
Yeah.
I can do some stuff. And the Lord's never like, yeah, write a book about that. He's like, you know how you're scared of everything? Write a book about courage. You know how you always quit when things get hard? Write Looking for Lovely about perseverance.
Wow.
You know how you wonder if I'm kind? Write Remember God about to see if I'm actually kind. I mean, it is like brutal. It's brutal work.
Yeah, but it's real. And I think that's what probably resonates with people. It's because it's so authentic. It's coming from your core, you know?
Thank you. Yeah, it does. It really does. And it feels like, man, when I taught school, I had opportunities like this too. This isn't like an author gift or an author problem, right?
Yeah.
This is whatever God has called you to, it is going to have moments where it feels too vulnerable and too personal and too challenging. And you get to walk to the other side of that and see what kind of difference you can make on the planet.
Wow. Well, I have to tell you this because now I'm going to start saying that you and I are like, you know, sisters from another mother and father. Because I used to teach school too, even though I've worked in marketing. Yeah, I taught English. I taught middle school, high school, and university. And
oh my gosh.
When you said that about your teacher, I wanted to scream, but I contained the
You're a professor is the difference.
Well, but I taught middle school and high school too. And I just, it touches my heart too, because you know, the teachers are so important and so valuable. Yeah. And so,
you know, one of the things I say a lot is I have one skill set. I entertain people until they learn something. And that's literally all I did with fourth graders. Beautiful. I just like entertained them until they went home with something that matters. And it's still what I do now. I am the same skill set. The Lord's just given me a couple of different ways to express it.
That is a good skill set, honey. That's a good deal.
I'm having a good time most days. So
it's good. So if people want to check out your books, you know, where do they find you?
I'm embarrassingly easy to find is the true street. I'm Annie good. F. Downs everywhere. Good. Instagram, Twitter, Facebook, my house, Annie F. Downs. That's the website is anniefdowns.com. My podcast is called That Sounds Fun. Comes out a couple of times a week. And then the books are everywhere you love to buy books. I'd always encourage people to start with your local bookstore and go outward after that, but start with the people who are in your town that are curating what your people love to read. Start there and then work your way outwards. But Annie F. Downs is where I am all the time.
Nice. I feel like the F could be for fun.
Okay, we'll take it. I usually say fancy because I like that one too.
I like all those.
I'll take it.
Awesome. Well, Annie, it has been so wonderful getting to visit with you. I feel inspired. I'm actually thinking about doing the 100 days group with my team at work. You've inspired me today. So I want to do that as well. So.
Well, listen, if we can get you some books, you know how to find me. Let me sign some and send them to your team.
Yes. So hopefully you guys are encouraged and uplifted by all that Annie has shared today. Go find her, Annie F. Downs. The F is for fun or fancy, however you want to swing it. And hopefully this has been great for you to be inspired and encouraged. Thank you. This is Sharing Hope.